Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your presence here among us, with us. Where two or three are gathered, we know that you are there. And we thank you for that. We thank you that you care about the least of the activities in our lives, Lord. And so we know you care about this library. And we ask you now, Lord, to give wisdom to the board members and to each person that will speak. And may your will be done amongst us here. Return us to our righteous roots, Lord. One nation under God, that we might be truly indivisible. In Jesus' name we pray. And that's why we're standing. Let's go ahead and do the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, I'm new at this, so give me some grace.
It's
going to
be great.
All right, so the consent agenda.
All right, there are four items: the minutes from July 25th, the financial report, only for July because we're still experiencing problems with the conversion over to Tyler, and so I won't be able to have that final June report for another month or so. The voucher register for August and the expenditure report for August.
So I just motion to see. Just approve it. Do I have a motion to approve the consent agenda?
I make a motion to approve.
Oh, wait. I'm sorry. I'll just turn this on. Okay, is it working?
Hello? I move that we need to make an amendment to the minutes because Chuck actually nominated me as treasurer, not Sage. Right? I nominated Chuck. Chuck nominated me. I remember this exchange very well. So I want to put it in pen. Yeah, but thank you for that honor. But yeah, it should say Chuck nominated Chelsea.
Okay, thank you.
Any other amendments? Do I hear a motion?
I make a motion to approve the consent agenda with the amendment.
Changes.
I'd like second.
And you second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All right, unfinished business.
Right, I'm being a pest because I know everybody's interested in the new board member training. So I've been assured by the county commissioner's office that we'll have a date set up before our next meeting. I'll have information and probably get something sent out to you sooner.
Great. All right, new business. So are we going to do go ahead.
Quarterly, we have the opportunity to meet with county commissioners if we have something that we would like to discuss with them. Right now, I don't have any projects or anything going on that I would normally bring to the commissioners, but if there is a reason that a board member would like to have a joint meeting, I can request that.
I don't have a...
All right.
Okay. So we're going to go into the library collection presentation?
Yes, we'll go into library collection management. This is a demonstration that was provided to Kushner Faber, and so I just brought the same staff in to talk about it with you. I'm Elizabeth Albin and
Sarah Kubacher. Do you want a mic? Yeah. Oh.
You're not the public. I'm sorry. I just didn't realize that constitutes the public. Staff constitutes as the public.
Okay.
Like Terry said, I'm Elizabeth Alvin. I am the Circulation Collections Manager, and this is Sarah Rozier. She is the new Tech Services Manager, which is the department downstairs that does all of our incoming and outgoing material. We presented this to Commissioner Faber when she asked for some like detailed notes about how we add books to the collection, how we take them out, and it's kind of a two-department thing. So I'm going to begin. It starts in my department, and then it ends up in Sarah's department. So first of all, we run what we call a weeding report, and this will see how many of our titles in our collection that we're weeding come out, haven't been checked out in a certain amount of time. So we would prefer to run that report for 5 years, but because we have some massive space issues going on in our library, we run it for between two and or three and four, depending on what area we're talking about. So the one I ran today, to give you an example, is the adult fiction one. We run this every month, so it had about 40 items on it. And these items had not been checked out since August 22nd of 2019. So it's about 40 items. So then after we run this report, we go to the shelf, we pull all these books off of the shelf onto a cart, and we physically look at every single one and says, is this number four in a series? If it's number four, one, two, and three are checking out, we'll leave it on. If it is, you know, some that's in really good shape, still looks like it might be something that would be intriguing, or maybe we know of a series that's coming out that it's, you know, going to be popular again, we'll leave it on the shelf. So we literally look at every title and say, do we need to keep this on the shelf? Do we not? And then also, Sarah's going to have some examples in a minute. If the item has been, like I have an item on this list that's checked out 77 times, so it's probably going to be pretty grody. We call them grubby. That they go out the door more than 60 times. Their bindings are usually kind of shot and they're kind of and they have some questionable material stuck on the front page. So anyways, so we kind of go through that and kind of keep the collection kind of fresh and nice. And then when we decide what we are going to pull out of the collection, sometimes we'll put them back and we'll mark them as with our weeding cart so they don't show up on our report again next month and they won't come back for another year or other 3 years or 4 years depending on when we run the report. And then once we decide what we're gonna take out of the collection, we mark them discard in the system, and then they go down to Sarah's department for the next step.
The next step in the discard process is I run a report. Everything that gets marked discard by staff members, we run a report, and they're permanently deleted from our collection. That report is available. And then things are put on rolling shelves in the tech services department. And they've all been stamped with our discard stamp, and then Tech Services' job is to go through each item on those rolling shelves, and we either put them in boxes for the book sale, or we put them on a cart to be thrown away. And the ones that are thrown away are typically either something with outdated information, such as Windows 8.1 from 2013. That's not something we foresee selling in the book sale, because it's outdated information. Or a book from 2013 on diabetes. We feel that, you know, the information has been updated and we don't want people buying things that could potentially be misinformation. Travel books from 2010, mostly outdated information. And then typically it's books like this that are falling apart, broken bindings, water damage, stains. That's a lot of it is just damaged items. And so then the boxes of books are put on the stage right behind you, and then they are kept there until September for our annual Friends book sale.
I have a question. So the books that are damaged that have been well loved, do you replace those?
That is up to the department that has marked them as discard. Often they are.
So if they come up on our report that they haven't checked out in 5 years, or three or four, depending on when we ran the report, we probably won't replace them. However, when we're in the shelves pulling out some weeded material, we will find some of these that are like well loved, or duplicate copies or something, and we'll like, oh, that needs to be freshened up. And that won't ever go down to Tech Services. I mean, well, the damaged book will, but we'll have the replacement already done in our department. That's not, we build carts up in our departments.
And this is a monthly report?
So every department does it differently. Okay. You can set it up however you want. Some departments do twice a year. We do it in fiction once a month because it's a little bit easier for us to keep the collection fresh. Because fiction is being published, it's more of a highly published collection. So every department does it different. So you'd have to ask, if you're curious about one collection, we can definitely get back the answer, but everybody does it different. They also do it different on space issues as well. So because we're pretty space crunched in fiction, we do it a little bit more frequently.
Any other questions?
Does each department have its own database of books, or where's the, you have a list, I see. I hope you didn't type it all out.
I did not. So we have what we call our Blue Cloud system. It's from the same software that we run our checkout system from. So our checkout system is Workflows, and our database system is Blue Cloud, and they're both Sears United programs. So you can go in and you can create a report that says, I want certain parameters, I want certain department or a certain collection, I want certain date ranges, and et cetera, and you could just click submit and it'll run the report program. So it's a database program. So you can kind of plug it into your parameters. So that is, back to your question, the circulation department's reports are set up every individual person. So the person that orders fiction meets fiction, the person that orders mystery meets mystery. Person that orders juniors, we juniors. So that way you have a better idea of what your collection is. And then you can set up your own, every department sets up their own personal, depending on their date ranges and their.
Now, does that database connect to the state database, the WILD system?
Yes. Or? Yep. So CIRSE Dynext is the state program. So every library that runs from CIRSE Dynext has access to the Blue Cloud report.
How many departments are there?
How many departments?
Yes.
Seven, including Rent Ranch? Is that correct?
Eight
including Rent Ranch. So there's reference, circulation, children's and YA, which we combined as youth services, but the children's and young adult, extension, administration, and then tech services and Rent Ranch.
Okay, so but tech services isn't part of collections, right?
We don't
order materials. Okay, I guess my question. How many departments would be discarding books?
Well, I see what you're saying. So we have what we call floor departments and then departments. So the floor departments are the ones that have collections in there. So circulation, reference, youth services, extension services, and Rent Ranch are the collection ones.
So basically five. Would,
yes.
Would be doing reports on what needs to be discarded. Or
correct. Based on their own, yeah. So reference is in charge of the adult nonfiction. Circulation is in charge of adult fiction and AV, which is audiovisual materials. Youth Services is in charge of the Easy Junior, Parenting, and Youth Services collection. And then Right Branch is, and then Extension Services is a large print and outreach. And then Right Branch does that entire thing on a smaller scale for their own library.
Okay, so now.
Can you speak up so we can actually hear you on the camera?
So. Am I to understand that each of those departments only print a report on discards on occasion, or is it monthly?
Yeah, I cannot talk because I'm not sure. It will be within a year span. So it might be twice a year, it could be 12 times a year. It all depends on their space.
So they don't determine on throwing them out every month then, but?
They might. However, like I said, I don't know. Every department's responsible for their own. So, Terry, do you have an idea of time they run in youth services?
Yeah, I think that you guys are probably, doing a little tiny section once a month. Some departments tackle a big section and do it over several months. So it just depends. It's easy in genres in adult fiction. You could hit a mystery section pretty quickly. But if you're going to look at all the picture books in the children's department, that's quite a task and it's going to take long.
Yeah, also the children's department does have a couple more check marks on theirs that we don't. So they're also responsible to making sure they have reading levels for all the children that can come in and say, I'm reading level 5. You know, writing little exile reports with the school. So they have a couple more check marks on their reading list that we don't. So it does take them a little bit longer to go through their reading list that they would take to the shelf and do this than it does ours. So ours is more like a yay or nay, but they have to make sure that they're keeping a collection that matches up with English departments at the school, teachers' requests, reading levels. So they have those kind of stuff that we don't have in adults. So there is a couple more check marks in the youth services department.
Thank you.
There's always a lag, a couple seconds, a second.
It's not working. Maybe the batteries are dead.
Okay, so I got to go to quite a few trainings with you ladies, learning how to use Blue Cloud, and when I was a staff member. And I also got to be a part of the beginning of the Easy Friction Raid that took forever. It took us like 7 months or something before they could finish it. It is quite the task to go through all of the picture books and look at those. If you've been in the children's section, now the shelves are more free, but before the shelves were literally bending under the weight of how many books we had in there, and what a gift to be blessed with so many. However, I went to the recycling center because someone said to me I should go to the recycling center and get free books because we love the book sale. I helped set up for the book sale. I buy as many books as my kids can hold to get out of this room, and we love it. And I was really disappointed. I found a whole box, letter H author, and it was during the Easy Fiction read, and I just was really disappointed to find that many of that were clearly just straight from the book, the book weed that we did on Easy Fiction. And so I think that's why some of this is brought up, is because we found so many books at the recycling center, and it was disappointing to find so many that were in good condition. None of them looked like that. And so I just wanted to express my concern and my frustration. And it's not.
So,
is there a question? No, but I wanted to express my frustration with that.
So there is many ways that the books did get to the recycle center. So, Terry?
So I investigated this very problem because it didn't make sense to me. And I had been at a county commissioner's meeting where I was told that books were being hauled, children's books were being hauled to the recycling center every day. And I'm like, what is going on? That's not how we do it. We discard every other month, and we send the books in plastic containers rather than buying a bunch of boxes. So we're sending them in plastic containers, and so they're not in boxes. So what I found out when I was able to talk to the recycling center is that an employee there is very passionate about recycling. The public was discarding, or throwing out a lot of books, or trying to get, and she like grabbed those books because they are recycling books up at the recycling center. It's just not very cost effective because they found out they have to shave off the binding part of those. Anyway, I found out that she said they get so, once the public saw those shelves there, those giveaway shelves, they started showing up in droves with boxes of books. Now, I can't tell you why they were alphabetical, but I know they weren't in the containers that we send them to the recycling center in, so I don't have an answer for you for that. But I did look into it thoroughly, and I'm convinced that these books are coming from somewhere else. Maybe, you know, we give away a lot of children's books to Boys and Girls Club or different things. Maybe they ran out of space, or maybe they had them in order. I can't tell you, though. I don't know. But I know that it was not us.
So when I was looking through the policy, the policy for collections, it said that we don't give away, I mean, we don't read out a lot of books for the young adult fiction and the junior fiction area. So is our spacing full right now? Do we know?
I can't speak to how full it is, and I'm not sure where in the collection development policy it says that, so I have to take a look at it. Darcy, are you here? Would you like to speak to it?
I am here. Mm-hmm.
have a mic for you, if you would like.
I also, and I apologize, I may not have heard everything you said, but I'm not sure where it says that we don't weed often. We weed in chunks, as Terry was talking about, and so young adult fiction is approximately every 18 months to 2 years, and we do it in one fell swoop, the entire collection. Young adult nonfiction and our children's nonfiction are more on that 3 to 5 year basis. Again, you don't want material in a collection, particularly for kids who are doing research that's out of date. But our space, I guess the question was more to space. Our space is very full. So we'll start young adult fiction. I am so sorry. We'll
hold the mic out a bit and then it'll stop, I think.
Thanks. We'll start young adult fiction. We'll start young adult fiction reading in September, actually. It's been about two years since we last weeded that collection. So as we're buying new books, we have to weed out the old books or the things that aren't circulating. We did just finish Easy Fiction. That we started in March of 2021. So we're 18 months in that process. March of 2021, 25,000 books, and we've just finished that process. As Elizabeth was saying, that is a much more intensive process. Not only do we have to make sure that we've kept what are grade level appropriate books in the collection, but we have something called the Children's Core Collection, which is a collection of what's considered classics, and we have to evaluate books according to that as well. So it's a real tedious and time-consuming process. My staff has been on that for like 19 months, something like that. But we do it so that the shelves are not so full. We do it to accommodate getting new things in, but we also have to consider our patrons and our audience. It can be very overwhelming to go to a collection where it's so full and you're having to pull books out that are literally sticking together because they're so tight in order to get the books that you want. So there's a concept in librarianship about access and about right sizing a collection, and we have to keep that in mind too with our shelf space as well as our patron experience. So one of the things that we hear anecdotally from the patrons who come in, and Chelsea spoke to that, was how nice it is that the Easy Fiction is so much easier to browse. It looks cleaner. It's a lot more welcoming of a space. So I'm not sure if I totally answered your question, but yeah, our space is always at capacity, and we are definitely looking at ways to make that collection more usable for our patrons.
I think I just need a clarification, because it said books are kept as long as they are readable condition and continue to circulate.
Yes.
So it just didn't give me the timeline.
No. And so that's really that call. We're looking at circulation data, we're looking at condition of the book, we're looking at all of those kinds of factors. It's a very data-driven process where we're establishing lots of parameters for how we lead that collection.
Thank you.
I guess the only other question I had is the books that haven't been circulated, gone out of favor. Have they been marketed? Are they just old? Out of fashion? Or
so there's a couple different reasons. I'll speak to that. So like Sarah covered, there are such out of date ones. Plus, there's some with covers from the 1990s that people look at and they're like, I'd rather have something that has a newer cover.
Right.
So if there's, if we've had a book that's been circulating 70, 80, 90 times, and you can tell it's still popular, maybe the binding's not broken, but the cover looks like it's 25 years old, we will update that book with a cover that's a new cover, looks nicer, so we will take a book that's circulating out and put a new replacement in there. You said something earlier, and I was gonna address that too, I can't remember what was the, marketing. Yeah, so we do, I'll speak to fiction. We do a display called a blind date with a book, and it's books that haven't been read. So we will come, some of our reports, this one doesn't have any, but they'll have ones that have zeros on the circulation, and we'll pull those out and wait for a month or two and make a display. And yeah, a lot of times they will circ from that. But some of them are just outdated, and they're just no longer popular. So like, I'll speak to an example. So Carrie Fisher was very popular. You know, Carrie Fisher is the lady who played Princess Leia in Star Wars movies. She has two biographies, and we had that in the collection. She was, you know, popular for a time and then went out of popularity. And she came up on our reading reports. Those books came up on our reading reports, and we did not pull them, knowing that a new Star Wars movie was coming out in a couple of years. So we left them on the collection. Well, the new movie came out, and then 3 months later, Carrie Fisher passed away. And we had 25 people on each book on a hold list. So sometimes there's just, you make a judgment call saying, maybe it's not popular now, but it might be, it could be. And then, you know, sometimes you're like, it will never be popular, you'll get rid of it, and they'll announce a movie 2 weeks later, and you're like, seriously? And you have to go order the book. So we try our best. We try our best with the community and know what they check out. We really try to keep what's on the shelf that we think is going to be popular, or order what we think is going to be popular.
So I guess that was my next question, is how do you guys, I'll have to do well and everything on ordering, but you know, do you guys look at your own metrics of the stuff that you ordered and to see how good of a buyer you are, to see if you have a good pulse for the your audience?
Yes, so we run, so that Blue Cloud can run all your statistics, and you can say, okay, so obviously I'm ordering mystery. My murder mysteries are like super popular right now, and so you're going to spend a little bit more on the murder mystery side as opposed to like, you know, the historical, the more the true crime kind of, because you know that they're checking out. But in 3 years, it could swing back. So you're constantly running those statistic reports on your own ordering, saying where am I spending my money the best? Where am I seeing what the patrons want? And that way, you're spending money wisely with what is actually checking out. We also balance it between our digital collection and our physical collection. So sometimes something's cheaper digital than it is physical. So we'll say, well, maybe this might only have 2 or 3 checkouts. So instead of spending $70 for a physical one, we'll spend $20 for the digital one. And then, you know, so we also make those judgment calls as well. We also judge ourselves according to other libraries. So Natrona and Laramie County, so the Cheyenne Library, also have a lot of the same metrics we do. So we'll also say, well, our patron requested this. Natrona has this, checked out 40 times in 5 years. Probably our patrons would also like it. So we kind of judge that way as well. Cool.
Very interesting. Any other questions? All right.
Actually, I hate to ask Darcy, but I feel like she has a better explanation for the children's department about how they order. Darcy, do you mind explaining that to everyone? Because I probably have gaps. Or is that
ordering's a whole different level?
Oh, I mean the metrics part. Like you were saying, how you know you look at. Maybe it should be a different day.
Yeah, we've got a lot of other things going on.
Okay. Sorry, different day. Thank you.
That sounds good to me.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, girls. All right, now on to the American Library Association. There's been a lot of stuff circulating about the ALA. And so I just thought that we would just hit this straight on and talk about it and see what if we're going to do anything about it. So here we go.
Okay. All right. Well, I have some information here that I'll review, and then if you have some questions, I'll be happy to answer them. So the American Library Association was founded in 1876. It was created by Melvin Dewey and others to provide leadership for development, promotion, and improvement of library and information services and the profession of librarianship. Today, it is the oldest and largest library association in the world. The ALA is a 501c3 nonprofit organization, and due to this designation, ALA is and must be nonpartisan. So according to some research published by Statista, there are over 119,000 libraries in the United States. Most, over 93,000, are school libraries. 9,200 are. There are also academic, special, corporate, government libraries, lots of different types, 145,000 library professionals, and 366,000 people are employed by libraries. So there's a lot of library staff out there. And the ALA is composed of these library professionals. Much like the American Medical Association is composed of doctors, the American Bar Association is composed of lawyers, and the National Education Association is composed of educators, the ALA is composed of library staff people. Like other trade associations, governance is made up by members. The term of the ALA president is 1 year. ALA membership includes a variety of people with a variety of viewpoints, and there are a lot of disagreements within the association, which is not unusual for any association. The ALA does not have any oversight over Campbell County libraries. The library itself is not an institutional member of the ALA. How is it funded? Well, it's funded through membership dues, proceeds from publishing activities. They publish a lot of library books that may tell you some strategies for how to, you know, how to do facilities maintenance in a library or how to do a strategic plan. So there's a lot of different books like that that are published by the ALA, and I have several of them on my shelf in my office. They also make money from proceeds from conferences and educational programs, and they also get grants. Since there are so many types of libraries and different audiences that are being served, there are a lot of divisions in the ALA, like the Public Library Association, for example. RUSA, RUSA is a Reference and User Service Association, so it can get pretty specialized if you want to you know, learn more about which service you specifically offer. AASL Association, American Association of School Librarians. YALSA, as we've talked about, is the Young Adult Library Services Association. There's also one for children, ALSC, Association for Library Services to Children. So there's management associations. There's a lot of different types of associations within the ALA. Some of the recent ALA goals are to extend and expand the library services in America and around the world, you know, to support all types of libraries, academic, public, school, and special, to support all librarians, library staff, trustees, and other individuals and groups working to improve library services. Member services, an open, inclusive, and collaborative environment, ethics, professionalism, integrity, excellence and innovation, intellectual freedom, social responsibility and the public good, and sustainability. So those are the goals that they have at this time. The ALA does other things like issue book awards. Most well-known are the Newbery and Caldecott. Gillette's own author, Corey Tabor, was a Caldecott Honor winner in 2022. Very cool. Mel Fell is another one of his books. It won the 2019 and 22 Giesel Awards from the ALA for his books, Fox the Tiger and Fox at Night. So it's very cool to have a local author get that kind of recognition, and it does come from the ALA. And these are great books, and we have them in our children's department. So, how does the ALA influence what we do here at the Campbell County Public Library? In terms of training, we gravitate to conferences offered by the Public Library Association and at times the American Library Association, YALSA for young adults, and ALSC for children, but mostly PLA. We also participate in the work of the CSLP, lots of acronyms in the library world. This is a collaborative summer library program. It's a grassroots organization separate from the ALA that most states participate in, where a national summer reading theme is selected, and we're able to share artwork and get significantly better pricing on summer reading materials. So the staff do use library associations for a variety of purposes, to network or have opportunity and access to a broad spectrum of training. attend a trade show to get programming ideas, learn about publishing trends, evaluate purchases for the library. So that's the staff, but what is the influence of the American Library Association on me as the library director? Annually or every other year, I attend a conference. I review potential technology upgrades. One great example is our radio frequency identification system. It was purchased after we had a chance to see the system in action at an ALA trade show. And this technology has enabled us to inventory the entire collection, a process that once took years, in a timely manner. It's great, you take a wand, you don't have to take each book off the shelf, you just walk down the shelves and the little radio frequency creates a report that tells us if things are shelved out of order. It's a really wonderful system, okay? It's been a barrier to theft, and it's allowed patrons to use self-checkouts quickly and easily. We also learned about Overdrive at PLA, so we subsequently picked up this ebook service after getting a chance to look at it at a conference. So it's really helpful to us to, you know, to keep up with library trends, to have access to this technology and services. And so at the last ALA conference, I tested a portable kitchen that could potentially be purchased for cooking classes. I received a nice box of free samples of STEM kit items, such as circuit boards. And then I reviewed databases for potential purchase for the statewide shared purchases committee, of which I'm a member. I also attended classes, including one that involved mapping 2020 census data as it applies to gathering demographic information as you try to, you know, create good plans for services for your community. Conferences allow us as staff to learn about library trends, to discover technologies, to see what the library world is doing in order to bring the best possible service to our citizens. What is the influence of the American Library Association on our collection development? So I think I've seen that question come up. Our primary influence in collection development is our collection development policy, which is approved by the library board. Broadly speaking, our policy's goal is to meet the educational, informational, and recreational needs of the community. In terms of an ALA influence, the policy includes reference to the ALA Bill of Rights and a Freedom to Read statement, which is based on the First Amendment of the United States Constitution. In the day-to-day work of collection development, we pay attention to the things that that Elizabeth and Sarah and Darcy talked about. So that's how we get our collections developed. Regarding the influence of the ALA on me regarding issues of intellectual freedom, I can tell you that I developed an opinion about book bans and censorship in a fifth grade social studies class. And I learned about First Amendment protections for U.S. citizens to read and have access to information in a high school government class. These are classic rights, and while the ALA may also support intellectual freedom, the ALA has not influenced my feelings on these important, unalienable rights. Look, our collection development policy protects access to legally published materials. We are guided by a century of law based on the First Amendment of the United States Constitution, which also protects our freedom of religion. America's founding fathers believed that these foundational rights needed to be protected for America to thrive and prosper. It concerns me that chipping away at the First Amendment could have all kinds of unintended consequences. I know that there's a perception that the ALA is influencing this library to adopt liberal views, but that simply isn't true. Our staff lives in this community. Many of us grew up here and have Western values. I completely trust the staff to purchase items that meet the educational, informational, and recreational needs of this community. And I have proven several times that our collection leans towards conservative views, and this is because
This is what our public checks out. So, any questions?
Any discussion? So I asked Terry to give a defense of the ALA because we've gotten some emails and different things. And then I asked her to give us all a publication of an ALA magazine so we could have an informed discussion of the ALA. So, anybody want to chime in?
Well, I was a member of the American Bar Association for decades, and it looks to me like it's a sort of similar trade organization for things like libraries. That was the first issue of theirs that I'd ever read, and it seemed like a pretty good magazine, as far as that's concerned. It's certainly better than, I wouldn't recommend the American Bar magazine to anybody. This was lots more interesting than that. Seemed to have sorts of articles you would think they would have on library business and forming, you know, doing technical things for maintaining collection. That was my impression.
Okay, I want to say I was a member of, I think, the WEA as a teacher, but I did not know everything that WEA did. I just was a brand new teacher coming out of college and thought, this is what you do. So I'm just curious, but you don't have to be a member of the WEA in order to be a teacher. So I'm just curious, as a lawyer, did you have to be a member of the Bar Association to be a lawyer?
Well, you have to be a member of the Wyoming Bar Association to practice law in Wyoming.
Okay.
You don't have to be a member of the ABA. At some point, I realized I didn't even read their dumb magazines, never went to one of their conventions, so I stopped being a member and nothing much changed. My impression was it represented large urban law firms more than anything else. And it wasn't all that relevant to, you know, doing law in a small town in Wyoming.
Okay, so you don't have to be a member of the Bar Association in order to
be a member of the Wyoming Bar Association.
Oh, Wyoming. Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's a whole different idea.
So our Wyoming Library Association and the ALA, do we as librarians have to be a member of those in order to be a librarian?
Nope, there's no requirement. I use it for a staff development tool.
Okay. I don't know if this is a good time to share something that I researched. Is that okay, Chair?
Sure, it's discussion.
Okay. So I was on Facebook looking at, I love following our library on Facebook, so you should do that if you haven't done that yet. Did a lot of great stuff, a lot of great reminders. And so I was on there and I went to the ALA Facebook page. And I feel like the majority of their agenda was very different from our Campbell County Library Facebook page. So I went and did just a Google search of, American Library Association top books. And I wanted to know which ones were the ones from when I was working at the library, because I read a lot of the books for like Indian Paintbrush and those kind of things. It was important to me to understand what my community was reading. So one of the most popular ones I found by the ALA, not in our library, is this book. It's called Fighting Words. And I bet just based on this room, I could ask how many people have read the book, The War That Saved Me. And so, Kimberly Brubaker Bradley, she's a great author. She has excellent work, and I applaud her for the things she writes. However, I came across this book, and I was astonished to find it in our junior fiction section. So I have a little thing I wrote here, just to make sure I don't forget anything. So she has said that she wrote this with an intention to express her story through fiction writing. And while I believe this book is a great work of art for the appropriate reader, I believe it is improperly shelved. Our library stands by the idea that parents are responsible for what their children read.
Fighting Words, that's this book, shares very real-life experiences that are not your everyday reader is prepared for. On page 134, a descriptive scene of a girl being molested by her mother's boyfriend could be a tool for a counselor that would be valuable. However, to my everyday reader, I as a librarian would feel very frustrated if I gave this to a student. Knowing that I've read The War That Saved Me, I would think, oh, Kimberly Brubaker Bradley, I love this author. You should read her next book. However, as librarians, we don't have to warrant or read everything possible on the shelf in order to be able to just recommend books. So I went ahead and I read, I printed off, if you guys want it, you can have it too, the Horn Book Review, Publishers Weekly Review, Booklist Review, and School Library Journal Review. These are all on our library Wildcat page. With every book, there is 4 reviews or more. And so as a librarian, this is what we would do. We would read the reviews. I'm not going to read them to you. I'm going to read the 2 sentences that were frustrating to me. So in Horn Book Review, it says, Suki is hiding a devastating secret about the time they lived with her mom's boyfriend, Clifton, a secret that causes her to wake up screaming at night. Okay, so I know this as a librarian, and I think, okay, maybe this might be good for a child going through abuse. I think this could be a great book that could be used as a tool to help someone come through, overcome something. However, I'm like, I still don't know everything about this book, right? Like, librarians don't get the book in their hand when they're ordering it. So I'm reading the other reviews. So Publishers Weekly doesn't say anything about that experience in their review at all. The Booklist Review says the trauma of sexual abuse is omnipresent, even before it's named, though the details of what happened are left largely unsaid. So that's all it says about this molestation scene that's very graphic in the book. And then School Library Journal Review says, when Suki catches Clifton molesting Della and takes pictures for evidence, the two ultimately end up in protective custody. As a librarian, I would not read all 4 reviews before recommending a book to a child. I feel like they're trying to deceive us. This is not acceptable. This book is excellent work of art. It is deceptive to our librarians for what the process is for recommending books to students. I feel like we need a system in place that can show that this book might not need to be in the hands of every reader. This book is in the same section as Magic Treehouse. It shouldn't be available to me as a mom who's going to find Magic Treehouse to read aloud to my 5-year-old for kindergarten. I don't want this in the same section. I don't want my kid picking it up. Not because I can't put it back down, but because it's in the same area that we hang out in as a family. And it's not censorship. This is not saying I want to get rid of a book. I'm all about saying let's embrace literature. But I think it needs to be moved to a different area where my child can't just pick it up and read about a topic that I think would be a hard topic as a trigger for those that are not in a safe time or place. And then I think it would also be a hard topic for a child that's never been exposed to any of these issues. So the reason I went to that book was because I was reading about the ALA. So that was my research assignment over the past month I gave myself.
May I just jump in and say that as we're talking about the ALA here, speaking to individual books, I can't speak to it. Every review you read is not an ALA review. So it hasn't, none of those books are ALA reviews. They're independent publishers who wrote those things. Professional people who...
So are these each of these associations associated with the American Library Association?
No, they are not. None of the reviews that you discussed are part of the American Library Association in any way, shape, or form. So that's where a lot of confusion comes in. People don't understand that. So I'm glad you brought this up and I had a chance to make that clear. But speaking to each individual title here as we talk about the ALA, it doesn't seem relevant to the ALA, is all I'm saying.
I think I would differ with that to some degree, because if a library has books that are banned or censored, you can put those to the ALA, like you can let them know, and it goes on their list. So the ALA does give us a
list of all the books that are censored and banned and that are looked at across the whole United States. I have done a lot of research, and if you know me, I tend to read everything. So when I was looking at this, one of the first things in our collection development policy is the number two. It says, you know, we have the ALA statements on access. So we have the Library Bill of Rights, and we have the Freedom to Read statement. So, you know, I was in childcare, and I was, the NACI is the childcare organization. And over time, I would get the big, you know, magazines and stuff. And then as time came on, it was like, this doesn't fit our Wyoming guidelines. This is like, they're doing all these things back on the West and East Coast, but it doesn't hit us here. So I really thought about it. And then what came up to me, instead of looking at maybe the ALA statements on access and everything, is to look at what is the thought of the West that we live in Wyoming? Like, what is our thought? So I Googled it.
Google knows everything.
Google
what? Well, and I saw it, so. And then I had to send it to my husband so I could save it. So I found this Code of the West. And it was written quite a bit of time ago by James Owen, like way back in the day. And some of these, I really think, hit us in what I've seen the discussions on. So live each day with courage. Always take pride in your work. Consistently finish what you start. Do what has to be done. Be tough but fair. When you make a promise, keep it. Write for the brand. Talk less and say more. Remember, some things are not for sale, and know where to draw the line. You know, and to me, I could take whatever we have in the library and put something to each of those. And so, I mean, if you, you know, look it up, ponder it and stuff, because it's not saying, like, remember, same things are not for sale. You know, I'm not saying we should censor banned books, because I read everything. I just read this book the other day. It's like, which is a controversy book. The Boys Aren't Blue. What is that? Boys. But anyway, when I read it, I was like, you know, going. But the thing was, it really surprised me, because in the book, he was like, if this has happened to you, go talk to a counselor, go talk to somebody. It was way different than I thought it would be. And so I have found that sometimes it's our perception when we read something. So, but with the ALA, I just struggle with that, because I see an agenda that they're going for. And I think it's really subtle sometimes. But also, it's in the East, primarily, not the West.
Darcy, thank you. Can I just speak to that? I think that you, know, I understand what you're saying and bring up some points, but I'm, again, having trouble connecting the ALA to what we're doing here. Like I said, I've done some analytics on our collection. Our collection is pretty conservative. We do have people in our community that maybe want to read a book about Obama, and we have a lot of people that want to read a book about Trump. You can really see that in our collection. So there's going to be a mix of books, but the ALA doesn't even have a lot to do with that. It's what the people here want to read that has a lot to do with what we have in our collection. That comes first before any ALA guidelines. I know it seems like they're having this massive influence on us. We don't always agree with the ALA. We really don't. There's some things that I have strongly disagreed with. So I think you just have to understand that it's a big group of people with a lot of different varying opinions, and it doesn't necessarily mean there's having a strong influence on us here. It is in our collection development policy, like you pointed out, and like I pointed out, there are two different things that are really kind of broad statements that are supposed to be inspiring. They're not really down in the weeds to how do you create a collection kind of things. But that, I see what you're saying there. We can always look at that when we review the collection development policy and see how the board feels about it. But those are the only two things that refer to the ALA and the whole large policy. So I just wanted to mention that. And I don't think that it's the ALA. I think that the things that you're concerned about are separate from the ALA in my mind. I don't think that influences there.
Okay, sorry, Chuck.
That's okay. How many staff members are members of the ALA?
Currently four.
Four. Okay, so that is a minimal number. And that being said, I just wanted to, I've done my research too, and there's the Code of Ethics in the American Library Association, and I'm going to read part of it. I won't go through all of it because it's not wordy, but there's seven or so. But it says, as members of the American Library Association, we recognize the importance of codifying and making known to the profession and to the general public the ethical principles that guide the work of librarians, other professionals providing information, services, library trustees, and library staffs. Ethical dilemmas occur when the values are in conflict. The American Library Association of Ethics states the values to which we are committed and embodies the ethical responsibilities of the profession in this changing environment, information environment. Now, this is the part that got me. It says, we significantly influence or control the selection, organization, preservation, and dissemination of information. In a political system grounded in an informed citizenry, we are members of a profession explicitly committed to intelligent intellectual freedom and freedom of access to information. We have a special obligation to ensure the free flow of information and ideas to present in future generations. And that being said, and I've got further stuff here, and originally libraries were maintained a neutrality. They had no, I hate to say agenda, but they had no, they were neutral. And in my further reading, they have been forced into, some libraries have been forced into taking an agenda or aside. It basically would be aside. According to the ALA, anyway, and in all the research that I've done, and there's a huge amount out there. But that being said, with only four members in the present staff being actual members of the American Library Association, it would seem that would be minimal. But I'm still concerned with where it says we significantly influence and control the selection. Is the Campbell Gamble Public Library a member of the American Library Association? Is itself? No, it's not. Okay. So I'm just trying to clarify some of this stuff and get it out there, and that as a whole, I'm not real in favor of the American Library Association. Just because of this, they literally say we control and influence the information.
So this was, written by librarians, and maybe their thought is that we have a pretty high standard to maintain because we're the ones buying the books. So what does influence us? Well, the number one influence is what the people want to read, and then looking at holes in the collection to see if there's things that are missing. Is there a curriculum thing missing? Is there something that we should have that we don't? But it isn't, as I've said, and I can do the report for you again, if you look at some analytics, you'll see that our collection matches our community. It really does. And so we did make that happen, so that is where the control is.
So basically, community standards is that's what the people in the community want.
Yeah. What does the community want to read? It's so influential.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks.
So I would ask Terry if you could give me a report of the junior fiction and the young adult fiction, because when talking to families in the last month, there's a lot of families that are going down to the youth, adult, young adult area because the books, just aren't meeting their needs. And so that's just want to see where we need to, you know, like what the trends are.
A lot of equity, diversity, inclusion, which are the buzzwords of the left. I didn't see anything about how homeschooling has exploded in the last couple of years, quadrupled since COVID, and, you know, things to help. I mean, I just didn't see, that's just one example. I didn't see it being a bunch of different things. I don't care that they had that. It's just that there wasn't, it wasn't balanced at all. So that's how I felt about the magazine. That's only one piece of it, though, however.
Any other comments?
Because this is a hot topic, I'm going to ask the public to weigh in on this on a next meeting, not today. And I would like to have it set up so there's like a pro and a con for the ALA. And we'll do like 36 for a pro, 36 for a con, or depending on how many speakers there are. Questions?
Question. If the library does not belong to the ALA, what difference does it make? I mean, what are we supposed to be weighing in on? Allowing individual people to be members of the ALA?
Well, as I understand, we pay the dues of several people's memberships.
Yes, and we get that money back by having significant savings on a conference expense. That's our primary motivation for membership, is just to get those good deals.
So there's some influences still. And going to those conferences, again, you know, that's influence on us too. So I just have heard a lot from the community on this, and so I want people to be heard and put this to bed. So I want this to be community driven. I don't want to sit up here and be, you know, making decisions and not hear from the public. So my idea was to have people come up and say a pro and a con, and we'll go back and forth until we run out of a pro or a con, and we'll see where we're at. So,
if I might, Madam Chair, what's the goal?
What's the goal?
Yeah,
it's to hear from the public and discuss the ALA.
I think the thing is we four of us are new, and so we just want the understanding. We're here still hearing the same things from the community, and being new isn't going to put that other information down. We want to hear from you because we maybe haven't heard it. One of the questions I can tell you when I was interviewed is, what do you think about the ALA? You know, that was one of my questions. And I had to really think about it and go back and research it and look at it, because I didn't know. I mean, I know what the association is about, but I had no idea what the ALA did for the librarians. And I think it has some awesome stuff in there, some, you know, things that you can learn from, and other things, just like I found in the childcare one. But I also think we need to understand it, because I do think the ALA does drive some of our collections and how we get them. So,
well, and things I'm hearing, I want everybody to hear. You know, the people that are talking to me, I want everybody to know. I want it to all be out in the open, and so it's transparent.
Madam Chairman, is this the critique of mass resistance? Is that really what you're talking about?
What do you mean by the critique?
The agenda that mass resistance has that's been in front of this organization for the last year. I mean, is that what we're talking about when you're talking about a criticism of the American Library Association?
I guess I don't understand the question. Is it a critique of mass resistance?
Or no. By mass resistance?
No. I mean, Have they put poor stuff? Yes, but I've heard it all over. You know, like, there are other libraries that have seceded from the ALA that they don't have anything to do with them.
And from.
Well, they don't allow the policies in their libraries. They don't go to their conferences. They don't want their influences. And people have been saying we need to do that. And so, you know, I want to get that all out there.
Are you part of Mass
Resistance? Do you anticipate,
I'm not part of Mass Resistance.
Do you anticipate someone would make a statement of what the list of the issues are that you perceive or somebody perceives as being bad things with the American Library Association?
Could you put the mic up by your mouth closer, please?
I don't know if this is
Pardon me. That's what I'm having a hard time with, is exactly what are there charges? Is there, what is it there, about
there's
the ALA?
There's a lot. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that the ALA has puts out there as like adjudicated law, and it's not. And a lot of times when they go to court, they lose. And for like banned books, we don't ban books. In America, we pretty much do not ban books. But if they've been challenged, then they get put on a quote banned book list. They haven't been banned. They've been challenged.
Well, some of them have been banned.
Not really. Very few.
There's a banned books list. There's a challenged books list.
It's a challenged books list, but it's not really banned.
Yeah, it is. There is.
There are
two different things.
Well, it may not be banned anymore. I think some of the things we see on the banned book list are books that were, in fact, banned at earlier times that aren't banned anymore. And I think the reason to talk about them is just to show how things have changed over time. I think that's what that means.
Well, that's not what they say in their literature.
Well, who reads that? I have worked here for 31 years. You asked my husband, what does the ALA mean?
Then you can come up here and talk about that.
No, I'm just saying.
I'm just saying, this is why we need to have the conversation.
He wouldn't know because he's not going to pick up some random magazine. He just knows that I work at the public library, is what he knows, and I've gone to conferences. My husband could not tell you what the ALA means because it doesn't matter to him. You're wanting these people to pick up this magazine randomly so that they...
No, other people have done... Jane, other people have done research, and they're coming to me, and they're...
What people?
Is she recognized? Are we talking about public comment?
This is not public comment. You're right. So, this is what we're doing. I'm chair. This is what we get to do. So,
I was reading in this magazine, actually, we celebrate Banned Books Week here. We have lots of things that go on in the library that are... we encourage kids and adults to read banned books. Dr. Seuss is one of the authors. I know that my child and I read those. I'm just saying, there are books that are banned that are still readily available. When that Dr. Seuss book 2 years ago got banned, we did not rip it off the shelf in our public library. It's still sitting there. So how is it considered banned if it's still readily available in your public library?
We didn't ban it.
Of course it wasn't. The publisher decided not to sell it.
So.
Madam Chairman, would somebody please look into how George Soros is funding ALA before our next meeting?
You can do that research if you want to do it. Director's report.
We're getting ready for the Wyoming Library Association Conference. The American Library Association Conference in Casper in September. We have a human resources conference in Gillette that couple of my administrative staff will attend, and we have three employees going for their Masters of Library Information Science right now. So very pleased with the staff development going on in that regard. We have some great programming that we really try to meet the needs of the community. A Celtic fingerstyle guitarist, Eric Barlow, will be here. We're wrapping up summer reading, and we had excellent participation this year. Our popular Harry Potter series is promoted in Gillette and Wright with activities including reading challenges, an escape room, trivia, and more. This is all to encourage people to have a love for reading. Learn Your Library Fair promotes resources to assist parents and children discover helpful resources for homework and more. And I'm pretty sure we'll have some really good things for homeschool parents there as well. So we encourage everybody to come. Ride Read Car Show partnership with the Campbell County Classics and Customs offers outdoor fun, family fun, activities for all ages. The Regional Author Fair features Paige Lambert and James Chandler, who's Judge Paul Phillips. And we support and help new authors with a writing workshop and marketing opportunities. Our annual used book sale is really a popular event. It's hosted by the Friends of the Library, and it's coming September 21st through the 26th. And we're so glad because we're running out of space. Not everybody knows this, but we also accept donations from the public because books are sacred. You don't throw away books. If the library will take them, that makes everybody happy. So that is a public service that we do. We also accept the books and sell them at the book sale. There's an annual report for 2021. It was greatly delayed due to COVID. It just was distributed by the commissioners and the libraries contained in there. We do have a Banned Books Week theme in September. It's an annual program that we do. In facilities maintenance, our FOB installation continues. Our roof replacement is now scheduled for September, right after Labor Day. The priority is the south end of the building due to the HVAC. This room right here is where we have HVAC issues. People who want to cool this room down right now get a little bit of a shower because they run out of parts, and so they it's very tricky to cool down the room right now. So many thanks to the staff and facilities maintenance people who do that. The water bottle fountain was installed in the basement. We still have a painting project pending. A new fire panel will be installed this fiscal year. Funding to redesign the exterior front for more efficient maintenance was cut. And there have been numerous complaints from the public about the heaving cement, yellow tape blocking off areas for over a year, et cetera, and stuff like that. So we're hoping to address in some way some of these things, but it's taking time. The facilities maintenance staff did price out fixing the front of the library. They just were unable to fund it this year. So we'll do what we can. In Wright Branch, we're still waiting to get the exterior grounds, parking lot, concrete curbs taken care of. We did have more water in the basement from a recent rain. So that's an ongoing problem. We're getting ready to roll out Tyler training for the management team and key staff here in the fall. And we're also getting ready to implement a new online interactive public meeting room calendar to kind of empower the public to sign up for classes like craft classes or to request a meeting room in a more user-friendly way than what we're doing now. Lots of safety things going on. Sarah Kubacher-Rosier was promoted to the Technical Services Manager, which was held by Lori Kirchhoff, who retired after 42 years of employment with the library. We've finished up some library page recruitment, and we're currently recruiting for a 35-hour tech services specialist and a 24-hour reference position. The next page is just a list of the programming that we've done or that is coming up. Continue to be watching Overdrive closely. July circulation was record-breaking. Canopy was record-breaking as well, and that's a streaming video service. Our Library Foundation meets on August 30th. We're reviewing investment performance art insurance, library advocacy, recruiting new members, and approving the annual budget. And our friends at the library meet tomorrow. They're preparing for the used book sale, and they're reviewing some programming grants. Next meeting for us is September 26th. My concern is that it's going to be in Pioneer Rooms 1 and 2, because this will have the book sale in it. So I need to think about that. And that's everything.
What time does Friends of the Library meet tomorrow?
6 p.m.
Is that here?
Yep.
All right, so it's time for public comment. Gail Cruz.
Is it on? My name is Gail Cruz, and I taught for 35 years in school districts. So I have a lot of vested interest in these kids and our community. I am going to basically come here and say the things I always say, which is do no harm. That should be the first rule of any organization that works with children, right? Do no harm. And I'm very concerned about the books in this library that expose children to behaviors that lead to early demise, that lead to a lifetime of diseases, that lead to emotional harm as well as physical. Just the financial burden that comes with many of these diseases is amazing. And in the last board that we had, I printed off NIH, CDC, Mayo Clinic articles that supported that, and I will get that for you next time. I didn't think about it this time. And you can do your own research, because it's really easy to find. And so that's my concern, is that the books that we're putting out there are encouraging children to participate, to experiment, to do behaviors that can actually do them harm. And this group here is not the only one across America. There's many, many parent groups that are rising up that are very concerned about this. You know, the ALA, that's great. Have your discussions and everything, but what about the children involved? That's it. First Amendment, fine. But what about First Amendment? Where does that stop with children? Can I say anything to a child? Can I show anything to a child? Or will the police come knocking at my door? If I were to take some of these books out of your library and show them to the 8-year-old neighbor girl, would her parents call the police on me? Would they? That's something to consider. And yet, we're supplying these books, and many of these kids, I keep hearing this mantra, oh, it's the parents' responsibility. It's the parents' responsibility. Well, how many children come in without parents from surrounding developments? They wander over, there's no parent with them. If you have 3 or 4 kids, or even 2 or 3 kids, and you're in the stacks, and you're looking over one shoulder, and another kid pulls out a book, opens it up, and there's this wretched graphic image, you don't have time to get to them and say, oh, sorry, you can't look at that one. So the whole point of having all these books intermixed in where little children can get to them. I would be willing to bet every one of you saw something when you were young that made a lasting impression on you, and you can close your eyes now and still see it. How many, and you know, would you please not talk over me and have parallel conversations? You know, excuse me, it's very distracting, okay? Anyway, so what I have,
school, you know, parents are rising up. And I have, and I'm really glad you don't have this barrier anymore. It's been a long time since I rushed the board, believe me. And I found one group is bringing a law, federal civil lawsuit against a school district for these books, genderqueer being one of them. And it's based on Title 18, USC 1466A. I made a copy for each of you so that you can read it. And also 1470. And it's very, very clear what is a crime and what is not. Would you take money out of the
bank? Oh, I think this is your notes.
Oh, thanks. But basically, a little synopsis of that Title 18 statute says, the federal law that makes it a crime, now listen carefully, to show obscene materials to minors. It includes Section 1466A of Title 18, which prohibits anyone from knowingly producing, distributing, receiving, or possessing with intent to transfer or distribute visual representations such as drawings, cartoons, or paintings that appear to depict minors engaged in sexually explicit conduct and are deemed obscene. And Section 1470 of Title 18 prohibits anyone from knowingly transferring or attempting to transfer obscene materials using the U.S. mail or any means or facility of interstate or foreign commerce to minors under 16 years old. To me, that's pretty clear that the federal government is very concerned about exposing children to graphic images. And I tell you, some of the graphic images I've seen in these books, I've never seen before in my life. They make my hair stand up. So, you know, I think in all the discussion that we're doing, it's all great, but we have to get down to the basic. What is anything that we're doing in this library or school or any place else harming children? That's it.
Thank you. Cheryl Glenloff.
Well, I believe you already addressed my issue here because mine was about the ALA. So it sounds like the next meeting we can go ahead and do our research and present it. Because my question was just when you plan to disassociate, or do you, from the ELA and stop paying dues to them. And I have my email address back there on the sheet, or I can hand this to you, but I would like a response to that when that decision is going to be made, if it's going to be made. So that's my comment. And I know you probably can't comment on that right now. It's public comment time. But I do have an email address back there, so you can let me know. Thank you.
You know, we may want to think about the scheduling. Is it when we've had the vote discussions, we're packed and we're all, this is, we can't meet.
So I guess because of the book sale, it will be postponed to October. So the discussion will be postponed to October. So. Sandra Hunter, is that right?
Yep. My name is Sandra Hunter. I want you to know I received my first library card in 1957 from George Amos Memorial Library. My family has been here, my children have been here, my grandchildren are going to be here. And I want you to know, as new board members, I'm sitting before you and saying this library is a shining. This library is a shining star in Campbell County. And how you do your job is going to depend on how that stays in Campbell County. I'm very concerned, and I wanted to meet the people who were appointed to the board, because what happened here in the summertime was not good for the library, it was not good for the community, and I'm hoping you're thinking very heavily about that when you make your decisions. People come here for the money, for the jobs, but they stay here because of Camplex, the library, and some of the social programs we have. So keep that in mind when you make your decisions. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Sue Liesel. Sherry. Eva.
Sue said, could I take her spot?
Oh, yeah, sure.
My name is Vicki Swenson, and what I'd just like to say, nothing in particular about the ALA or what we're doing or not, is that...
You need to the table over there.
I'm a retired teacher. We're flexible. Thank you. I'm Vicki Swenson, and I am a retired educator. And I guess what I want to talk about is that we have to be very careful that we're not going down another slippery slope. That we went down the slippery slope last year, and it just kind of kept slipping. And when people talk about people coming to Campbell County because of the school, the complex and the library, they also come to the schools, and they come for professional jobs. And what I want to let people know, because I do have connections all over the state, and Campbell County is kind of gotten to be seen, kind of, is being seen as very radical. And what we have to be careful of is that we're not keeping people from Campbell County. And I do know a person who works for a company here that last year they were advertising for a lawyer. This person was in charge of vetting the people who applied. A man applied that seemed to be a very good candidate, and when he didn't come back with an application, he was contacted and said, are you still interested? I said, well, I was very interested, but when my wife saw what was going on for the library, she said, no way, we're moving there. So while there are people on the one side that are very vehement and very passionate and have their own good thoughts about what the library should not be doing or doing, I think we need to remind ourselves that this is an organization of professional people who are hired because they are able to run this library, they have the background for it, and I think we have to be really careful we're not going down that slippery slope that we went last year. And we need to talk about the things we're talking about. We're talking about the ALA and how does that influence or not influence and what it is. And I think that's the subject that we need to talk about. We don't need to relive everything that we did before, because I can tell you, with all my connections around the state, we're not very well respected anymore. And I'm not saying people shouldn't voice their opinion. I'm just saying, let's be careful. You are new board members. You are entrusted with the reputation of this library. And so I just ask you to remember that we hear a lot of local people, and we hear people, you're hearing from a lot of people who are on one side, and so do we need to rally people on the other side? I hope not. I hope that you'll be open-minded, and you will listen, and you will remember that you are the ones in charge of the reputation of this library. So thank you for letting me talk.
Thank you. Sherry.
She's not risking it.
It's only taken a couple of years to figure that out.
That's true.
Hi.
Oops. Oh, no! Oh, you should have moved
that. I know. I'm Sherry. And I'm up here. For one thing, I read the whole book, Finding Words. And I can't tell you how impressed I was with the information and the fact that it wasn't a book just about what happened to this girl, and it wasn't explicit. It wasn't. And you got information on how to get help as a 10-year-old. And sometimes when you're sexually abused, one in four females, one in six males are abused in this community. Have you looked at the blotter? For Pete's sakes, there's something about child sexual abuse in the blotter along with domestic violence every single week. And so we know that those kids are out there. And when they're going through this, they normalize that. They feel that this is normal. So why should they talk to anyone? And if there's a chance that they get to this book and read it, it's something that this kid, it could be life-changing for that kid in a good way. So I can't believe that it's a book that you would want to take out of a potential or a victim's hands that could just use it. And here again, it's a perspective, right? My point of view, your point of view. Your point of view does not include my point of view. And the things that I want are not the things that you want. But this library serves all of us. Okay? I have kids. I've worked with kids and families for 30 years. I have a lot of experience. I don't know what else to say about that. I'm dumbfounded. The other thing is I still don't understand. We're looking at the ALA, and what is it that we're going to take away the memberships? Is that the ultimate goal?
Just trying to get the public heard.
So but there's no action to be made. We're just going to listen to the public.
I mean, I'm not going to say one way or the other.
So it's a possibility?
It's a possibility.
Well, I'm just curious, because then maybe I know what to look for if I'm looking for something.
Yeah, you know, I'm trying to get all the information out there.
Okay.
I want the community to be heard. I feel like they haven't been heard.
You know what? I feel like we've heard the same people on both sides again and again. What more are you going to hear?
I think we've been tolerated.
We all have been tolerated.
On both sides, yes.
Yeah. And as far as an organization that is promotes training and education, she saved you lots of money by going to that. I go to trainings, and I still go to trainings, and it's not that I believe everything about that training, but I come back with really good nuggets of information, and it saved lots of money. Just something to think about.
Thank you, Sherry.
Thank you, Sherry. Deb Proctor?
I really don't have prepared remarks, but I do want you to know that I appreciate the time you give. I really, really appreciate all the work that the staff and the director has done for the library. Campbell County Public Library is indeed a shining star. When you read the county surveys for many past years, it's always gotten the highest marks of any of our institutions. And I hate to see it continue to be drug out with all this controversy. I have been a member of the American Library Association as a professional. I believe strongly in the strengths that they give to librarianship, but mostly I love that they promote literacy, diversity, education, and I hate to see the negative thoughts are coming out. So thank you for your work, work hard, listen to both sides. Have a good evening.
Thank you. Hugh Bennett.
Just so you guys know, there's a speaker right up here, almost right under where you were standing. So.
Let's try this side. I'm Hugh Bennett, and I don't think this is about money. I don't think it's about training. I don't think it's about what the rest of the world, America, Wyoming, thinks about us. I think this is a country where the Constitution put as much control as possible in the hands of the people within a community. It's a representative form of government that's a republic. Now, I'm hearing people talk about Campbell County having a black eye. Well, sometimes when you get in a tussle, you get a black eye. But the fact of the matter is, the next generation, my grandkids, your kids, are more important than what anybody else says or thinks. What you do today matters. We may never know the effect of our actions
have on people down the road. But we do know the difference between right and wrong. It is wrong to pervert kids. And it's wrong to permit children to be perverted for whatever reason. And this horseshit about freedom of speech and censorship is nothing but crap. The reason being, you don't have a right to pervert another person's kid.
You're missing the word.
Yes, ma'am. You don't have a right to give a kid a drink of alcohol. You don't have a right to show him obscene materials. It's against the principles in the state code of law. And it's against what Gail Cruz brought up here. If there needs to be any affirmation of whether or not it's right to protect children until they're old enough to make good decisions, the law code should help us to inform that decision. Now, as to the ALA, that'll be addressed at a different meeting, I understand. However, I don't see anything preventing this board tonight from sequestering the books that have been questioned over the last 18 months that have had challenges that were knocked down by a liberal board. I see no reason not to put those in the adult section going forward. And I think that would be a proposal somebody might consider making a motion for and voting on tonight.
Thank you. Susan Bennett?
Well, thank you, and thank you for the new board members. Wow, I applaud you for you guys stepping up. Not everybody has heard everything because very little has been done. And I came to talk about ALA. I will save most of that for next time. However, they were taken to the Supreme Court. The interest in protecting young library users from material inappropriate for minors is legitimate and compelling. And the Supreme Court's decision, it was United States against Alabama, they were asked to respect that. And they promote that all material is age appropriate for all children. And what I'd like to say is, first of all, the librarians that have worked here have been great. No one is attacking them. There's no need to defend their job or their library. I too have had my library card since George Amos was here. And I also know that that book, if a child found it that was not a victim, it didn't apply to, they could easily become a victim for books such as that. We are asking for non-censorship. Nobody's asking you to ban any book, Sherry. We're not asking for books to be banned. We're asking label victims of child abuse or put them in a section for parental guidance. Keep your books, but just protect innocent children. Protect their innocence for the third grader. Miss Leslie herself said that an eight-year-old could go to our library and pick any one of those books out. That is inappropriate. And as an early childhood specialist and a teacher for many, many years in this district, I can tell you that is not appropriate for children. If it's a child that's already experiencing transgender, LGBTQ issues, then have a section for that and let the librarian take them over there or get the parents' permission, can I show them these books? But don't blatantly expose everybody to it and try to normalize it for the rest of us for our Western conservative values. It does not fit. And I do want to say this. If you're wondering what kind of books, we want positive role models. We want wholesome educational materials that support our values and our Western civilization over here in Wyoming. We are not New York City or LA or San Francisco. And that needs to be taken into consideration. And yes, the ALA needs to be discussed because if you're being influenced on getting materials from them, you need to know that they don't have age-appropriate books for children. You need to know that George Soros is funding them, and I'll bring much more, because I too have done my research. And I, you know what, I see all these librarians coming up here, and we have the greatest library. Yes, I brought my classroom to this library, and I worked with Janet Tharp, she's my neighbor, and I know Deb Proctor, and I know all of you, and I don't have anything against the one of you. But I want to keep our library great. And that's why we're here, to continue to make rules and regs and procedures to keep our library great. And that this library is a safe place for all children. And so I just want to encourage you to look at your collection policies that you guys keep hiding behind. At least I know that's what we're not going to change this book because our collection policy fits in. Well, if you're going to have a children's department, then you need to have the responsibility of providing age-appropriate material for those children, not just exposing them to anything that isn't out there. Just like you said, you can't go to a store and give them alcohol. There are limits to what you give a child. And I just want to encourage this board to look at those policies and put down there, is this age appropriate? And are we looking out for what's best for children? First, do no harm. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan.
All right. Terry, you had proposed at one point to do something with some of those books. Is there any progress on that, or?
So we've had a couple of manager meetings to discuss. Not so much as doing anything with any specific books that have gone through the challenge process, but having different ideas that we're exploring neighborhoods and new adult sections are some of the things that we're talking about. I don't have anything firm. There's a lot of controversy in what we're talking about it, how to go about it, how much work it's actually going to be, how much it would be used or not used. So there's a list of things that I think would be great just to sit down and visit with you about when you've got some time.
So I don't know at one time we had talked about being able to put parent reviews in the front of the books and maybe having a grassroots type thing to do that. I would like to form a special committee of our people and have them do that. Is that something I can do with the board now, or how does that work?
I don't see any reason why not.
So I would like to form a special committee of seven people. I'd like to have people from both sides of the issue, so to say. So, Terry.
What?
Point of order.
Point of order, yeah. How do I do that?
We have to put it on the agenda so people have notice of a future meeting if you want to do something.
Okay. So
we
I need to wait
till
the next meeting. Okay.
Well, you have to have whatever it is, whatever your idea is.
Whatever my idea is, okay?
Put it on the agenda and we can discuss it and vote it.
Okay.
See what we want to do.
Okay.
Have discussion on exactly how that works.
How to do that. So.
Because there have been federal cases that talk about libraries and about, maybe I sent you copies, I don't know if I did, that talk about moving books from one section of a library to another.
Not what this is about.
Well.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm just saying that there are such cases that give us a good background on how, what kind of things a public library can do that way.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I think it would be a, whatever it is,
So that being said, Charlie, do we need to make a motion to form a special committee, or
I think that would be most appropriately an agenda item for another meeting, so that the public has notice of what we're going to do, and so we're transparent.
So basically,
people who might have been interested in this.
So it'll be a new business item.
Yeah,
sure.
So we don't need a motion then. We can make a motion next time. Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. So,
Madam Chair. I know that since we are talking about that and some collection, those types of things and stuff, I would put forth a motion that we pause all purchases of children's and junior fiction and teen fiction until we can, if we want to do it across the board for the whole library or if we just want to do the areas that have been out. So.
Again, point of order. That's not on our agenda. If we want to
It is on our agenda because we talked about collections. We've talked about the collections at this point.
But we haven't advertised we intended to take action. What's on the agenda is the discussion. They're not the same thing. But that can go on the agenda for the next meeting. We want the agenda to accurately reflect the action that people want to take. Not just have it come up as a surprise. At the end of the meeting without having any notice to the public that that's what people intended. We're guided by the open meetings law that requires that public business be taken in public and that the public has a chance to see what we're going to do. It's not saying that motion wouldn't be in order, It's just that it ought to be advertised first.
It's bar basically is new business.
New business, yeah.
New business.
That's right.
New business would be next meeting.
Okay, gotcha.
All right. So bring out his new business. Next time. Put on the agenda. Yeah. Anything else? All right. I guess we're adjourned. Thank you. Oh, we had a motion. Is there?
I so move.
You so move?
I'll
is there
second.
A second? All favor?
Aye.
Was there two words?
Can I get the no. I got next to you.